Welcome to the fourth video of Quantum Mechanics Done Right, the shortest path from novice to researcher. Today, we're going to start by discussing what is present in the first part of the book. It's the first four chapters, and it's focused on conceptual ideas. We're going to set the framework for how this works. As you probably remember from the earlier videos, I had described how nearly all quantum mechanics textbooks focus on developing quantum mechanics according to the Oppenheimer, Schiff, and Bohm paradigm that was developed in graduate quantum classes by Robert Oppenheimer during and after World War II. And even though since then we have had many hundreds, if not thousands, of quantum mechanics textbooks written and published, most of them are very close to that original book by Leonard Schiff. But starting about 10 years ago, there was a shift in the mindset of many people into thinking about alternative ways in which to teach quantum mechanics. So the gold standard for the traditional way of teaching quantum mechanics is David Griffith's quantum mechanics textbook. If you have never seen David Griffith's textbook, it is, I would say, probably the best written textbook of pretty much any textbook that I've ever written. David Griffiths has a remarkable way of making whoever reads the book feel very comfortable. He gives encouraging words, make you feel like you can do it. It's a hard book, though. It just throws you straight in the water and says, we're going to do Schrodinger's equation. That's the way quantum mechanics works. We're not going to tell you where it comes from. We're not going to motivate it very well. We're going to just throw you into the deep water and then teach you how to swim. But there was another alternative that came up by John Townsend, and he instead wrote a quantum mechanics textbook that started by working with the Stern-Gerlach experiment and spin 1/2. This was predicated on a way that Sakurai organized his graduate level quantum mechanics textbook, and Townsend wanted to bring that type of experience to the undergraduate level. And this has become a popular textbook. There are other textbooks that do spins first that are also popular. But we got into this notion of there are two ways to teach quantum mechanics. You do wave functions first, as Griffiths does, or you do spins first in the way that Townsend does. Now, I have to tell you, I don't agree with either of these. Essentially, all this is doing is reordering the same material. While it is true that perhaps some of the material is material that is worthwhile learning before other material, in general, it's really exactly the same material in both books. It's just the order in which you encounter them is different. And so maybe it's a question of, do I throw you into the deep end or do I walk you into the pool and then very quickly push you into the deep end? The way that I do it is very different. Physics education research has taught us that one should teach concepts before you teach formalism. So what we should be doing is not spins first or wave functions first. We should be teaching concepts first. And then after concepts are well understood, we should then move into the formalism that is used to explain the concepts and allow us to do more quantitative calculations after we've understood the qualitative features of quantum mechanics. So this is how I believe quantum should be taught, and it is exactly the way that the book has been organized. And this first part is the part of the book that focuses on quantum mechanical concepts. So what does concepts first mean? There are five fundamental concepts that we treat: superposition, measurement, complementarity, entanglement, and tagging. These concepts are illustrated with the Stern-Gerlach experiment, the delayed choice experiments, Bell experiments, the two-slit experiment, and an interaction-free experiments. And I know there might be some naysayers out there who say, well, you actually did start with spins, so you're a spins-first curriculum. Well, I'm telling you here that I really disagree with that. The focus is on concepts first, and then eventually we will move into developing the formalism. And we do start with spins because the concepts of spins and any two-state quantum system is easier than one that is a more complicated system that has many different states possible in it. In order to do this, all one needs is the bare minimum of math, just high school algebra and trigonometry. And so now let me go through those five concepts. The first is superposition. Superposition is not quanta being at two places at the same time. It is the phenomena of indeterminacy. Indeterminacy is not exactly the same as saying the object is in two places at the same time. Understanding this subtle difference is actually quite important, and understanding what indeterminacy is understanding what superposition is. It is the reason behind nearly all quantum interference effects, and it's what underlies most of the interesting quantum behavior. Measurement arises from an irreversible change to the system that allows me to determine something about the system. Destructive quantum experiments, such as a photon going into a photomultiplier tube, are the most common way in which we make measurements. And in that case, there is no measurement problem. For those of you who know what the measurement problem is, there are many physicists who have pondered over the question, where in quantum mechanics does measurement occur? Because the Schrodinger equation tells us nothing about measurement. It just tells us how the system evolves in time. Then something irreversible happens, and there's a collapse of the wave function during a measurement. Well, what I'm saying is when I have a destructive measurement, exactly when the measurement has occurred is very clear. It's when the particle was destroyed. There's no issue about what happens after the measurement because there's no particle left anymore. It's been destroyed. So there's no measurement problem. And indeed, most actual quantum measurements of single quanta work exactly in this phenomena. So the measurement problem is actually not a very important problem for understanding most of quantum mechanics. And that's one of the key concepts you need to understand if you want to understand measurement. Quantum measurements also require amplification because quanta are so small we can't see them. We can't detect them in any easy way. We need to find a way of amplifying the signal so that we can measure it. But we have to maintain that single quanta sensitivity, otherwise we're not measuring single quanta. And that's actually where the true measurement problem is, figuring out how to do that, which is a really hard problem. It is not that the quantum state gets magically entangled with some classical device and at some moment that we can't describe or know, collapse occurs. And it is not that the classical device that we can somehow miraculously entangle with has decoherence in it that allows the system to collapse. That isn't how the way measurement works, guys. Measurement works in much more sophisticated ways than that. And the whole measurement problem is just created to have a problem for people to talk about. It's not a real issue in most of quantum mechanics. Complementarity. This is what breaks indeterminacy. It is what allows us to have which way information. Whenever we have which way information, we lose interference. Many of you that have looked into questions of the measurement problem and what happens when a measurement occurs and how I can't have the information because to measure something, I have to destroy it and hit it so hard. No. That's old-fashioned quantum mechanics. There are clever ways and even very simple ways that you can do measurements that will allow us to have which way information and do not affect the particle that we're observing in any significant way. All that we need is the fact that we have this which way information in order to lose interference. Which way information can be erased after it has been created in cleverly designed experiments. These are called quantum erasers. They're often also called delayed choice quantum experiments. Entanglement is not just spooky action at a distance. Most of you have probably learned that entanglement is spooky action at a distance. No, that is not correct. It is not spooky action at a distance. It's much more robust than that. You can even have quantum entanglement with a single particle where nothing is happening at a distance. Everything is local. It is the way by which we get which way information. So when you have an entangled state, you won't have interference. And often when I tell this to people, they're kind of confused because they might have heard entanglement is the most interesting thing about quantum mechanics. Well, it is interesting. There's lots of interesting things that can be done with entanglement. But when you form entangled states, you usually lose the quantum interference, which is another interesting aspect of quantum mechanics. So entanglement tends to destroy interference because of the way that it's related to complementarity. And it's simply the fact that you have which way information that then tells you that you can't have interference. Tagging is a concept in which we can reversibly create entanglement, and then it allows us to remove the entanglement in a reversible fashion. And so this is a nice way of both creating and then removing entanglement, so I can either get rid of interference or have interference, depending upon how I want to create the quantum state that I'm working with. Now, in the second quantum revolution, we're actually able to create quantum states, and we're able to manipulate them in ways that we want to. So this becomes a really important concept to understand and be able to follow. So this creates some of the most interesting types of experiments, the delayed choice experiment, which I mentioned a little bit about previously. That's where you change something in the experiment after the quanta has gone through the device, sometimes well after it's gone through the device, and yet it will change the outcome. Often, if you look at videos on YouTube, they'll talk about retrocausality. There is no retrocausality needed to describe these experiments. Anyone who tells you that doesn't know what they're talking about. The way in which we focus this part of the book is by using conceptual models developed by Richard Feynman in his QED book, which is quite simply one of the best physics books that you can find on any subject. It's a remarkably good book. And another one that is absolutely excellent is Daniel Steyer's The Strange World of Quantum Mechanics. The work that we have in the first four chapters is very heavily influenced by these two books. We also are very heavily influenced by Ed Taylor. Ed Taylor was a professor of physics at MIT. He wrote a number of very influential quantum textbooks. His not just quantum textbooks, actually textbooks. And his quantum textbook is a book that he wrote with his colleague at MIT, French. And he wrote a relativity book called Space-Time Physics with Wheeler. And there are two volumes for the space-time physics, one which focuses primarily on special relativity and one which focuses on general relativity. In my opinion, those are the two absolute best books to learn relativity. Again, you don't need very much more beyond a high school preparation to understand and follow both of them. There's a little bit of calculus that is used, but it's really a very little bit, and you can get through most of it just with a high school background. Highly, highly recommend both of those. Ed Taylor is the person who first said, let's take those images from QED and animate them. And I met him after he had created a set of really rather clunky animations on that, but that has inspired a lot of the work that I've done, and I'm very thankful to Ed Taylor, and I'm very thankful for having met him in the mid-90s and learning so much from him about how to teach quantum mechanics really to everyone. Hey guys, let's do quantum right.